welcome back. I would like to welcome Parliamentary Secretary in European Matters. Thank you very much for being here. I would also like to welcome others, and I have met my colleagues already this morning, and also a number of organizations from the civil society organizations. And this theme now is priorities and program of the Latvian presidency. I hope that you'll be able to stay with us to listen to the colleagues and also participate in debates. So that would be great. But of course, in case you have to leave, unfortunately, we can't help it. Thank you very much. Dear President, ladies and gentlemen, members of the discussion panel, it is my pleasure to be here with you in this event, and on behalf of the Minister of Foreign Affairs, it is my pleasure to welcome you here in Riga. We meet here at a time when Latvia has already covered her way, half of the presidency, and now we can look back and see the first results and see also the types of work that we have to do in the coming months. I would like to say thank you to the ESC, to the workers group for the cooperation that we have had over this time. That's extremely important because we're trying to implement very important initiatives for every citizen of the EU. If we have a good look what has been achieved over the 3 months of Latvian presidency, we see quantitative and qualitative results. If we look at the quantitative data, in Brussels, more than 500 events have taken place organized by the Latvian presidency. In Latvia, more than 50, and about 10 that involved NGOs, social partners, and others that have attracted more than 1.5 people. In Latvia, we have hosted more than 800 guests who have come here to attend presidency events in the EU Parliament. We have organized 24 thematic debates, more than 30 hours all in all in the plenary meetings. We see that we have managed to provide 10 sunny days for Brussels. Now, when we turn to the qualitative results over these 3 months of intensive work, on the one hand, it is my pleasure to say that we have received many positive evaluations, but we realize that much more needs to be done. I would like to say, to mention the 4 or 5 major achievements that are visible. Firstly, the European Strategic Investment Fund, or the so-called Juncker's Fund, and we see that Latvia's approach has allowed us to come to an agreement in the Council in a very short time. That's a unique precedent. when we have an initiative of a huge volume, we have achieved complete agreement in 2 months, and we do hope that over the next few months we shall be able to achieve more agreements with the EP. The fund envisages more than 315 billion investments for education, for training, pharmacy, IT, health services. These are all the areas that will stimulate EU economy. The Strategic Investment Fund can give twofold contribution. First of all, that's investment for also consumption in the long run, and secondly, it will achieve its aim and achieve a growth in the potential of economy in the EU. And we hope that the fund will be working fully from June, July. The second achievement is energy union. During this presidency, we started the procedure of the establishment of this union. It started in Riga, and the European Commission has come forward with its proposal, where there are five mutually connected dimensions: economic solidarity and security, energy security, and also intensive economy and the raising of competitiveness. We shall have intensive work to develop these dimensions. It has a global meaning. It is also a security dimension. And the European Strategic Investment Fund will have a very big role in the establishment of interconnections. Thirdly, work that is connected with the increasing threat of terrorism and the need to enhance internal security in the EU after the tragic events in Paris and elsewhere. That's why we had to amend our agenda and think about struggle against terrorism. Already on the 1st of January, the Ministry of Culture in Europe announced a new statement about the freedom of speech, and also combating money laundering. And here in Riga, they passed a joint declaration on the prevention of terrorist threats that envisages very concrete steps in border control on the external border of the EU. And on the 17th of March, a joint declaration, eradication of discrimination. And this work will be continued. One of the decisions is to establish a register of passenger data, and we hope that during the presidency we shall be able to come to an agreement with the EP. Fourthly, the situation in Ukraine and the EU relations with Russia. Time has passed, and the crisis in between Russia and Ukraine has shown that we must preserve unity of the EU, which we have managed, and also the need to comply with the Minsk agreement and apply economic sanctions and restrictions in traveling for those military persons of Russia who are responsible for the events in Ukraine. The situation that we're in means that there's a military situation in one part of Europe, and the Council passed a decision about strategic communication and its enhancement. Starting with January, the Euro Council have made very important steps in strengthening European strategic security and strengthening the services and giving the task to prepare a communications plan for the Council of the European Union. This insecurity is created by the use of hybrid war methods in Eastern Europe, and also the threat that comes from growth of radicalism and terrorism threats. So where we need strategic communication to lessen the trends that are there when we see growth of radical views and activities of radical organizations to attract young people. I think we have the proverb from Latin, which says that a common threat may be solved by coordinated actions, and here coordinated action is very important, and we hope that in June we shall be able to get the strategic coordination plan for communications. I would also like to mention a number of other things that we have worked at in presidency. It is my pleasure to present at the EESC about a plan for a competitive digital Europe, and we need to continue work at the improvement of single market and all possibilities to avert any obstacles in it. And we have conclusions of the Council of Ministers. Much attention is paid to employment, where Latvian Presidency had organized the discussion focusing on three priorities: investment, promotion, structural changes, and responsive social policy. And we also have conclusions of the Council about inclusive labor markets, which is also a priority of Latvian presidency. This way, it is important to improve the labor market in the EU, adequate income, a safe shift or transfer for another job, and others. These are the among the conclusions of the Council. Especially the need to create qualitative jobs is very important, because so far we did not achieve it. It's very important to do that in the future. It is also important to eradicate inequality and diminish in-work poverty. Over the first 3 months, Latvian presidency has worked at a number of draft laws about market protection and telecommunications single market. So there's a new approach to roaming. And there is a proposal. We have started negotiations with the EP, although they're not easy. We hope to come to an agreement over the next months. And how to balance the interests of the industry and the consumers, and how to find solutions, and also try not to raise the basic tariffs. That's very important for the population. As to digital economy, we have started discussions about the use of digital potential for economy and the possibilities of digitalization of economy about involved Europe. The German translation is not common three, it seems.
Christoph, ça va? Okay, merci.
Dear colleagues, the third priority of our presidency is involve Europe. As already mentioned, Russia and Ukraine are the issues that have dominated. But the European Union has been capable of taking specific decisions. There was an agreement about providing macroeconomic assistance to the amount of 1.8 billion to Ukraine, and I think this is a very important decision. It's been approved. Another success is the ability of the EU to keep united point concerning the situation in Ukraine, and to maintain the sanctions imposed until all the decisions of the Minsk agreement are put into reality. So there's also a question about the relations with Central Asian countries, and in particular this is the opinion also that's been provided concerning the relationship between the EU and Central Asia, to take into account all aspects of all the involved parties, in particular transit, education, and stimulation of democratization, and the Central Asian dimension will be continued. Particular importance can be accorded also to the agreement transatlantic partnership, where negotiations are continuing with the United States. March 25th, during the informal meeting of ministers for trade, ministers discussed not only the procedure of these negotiations, the progress of negotiations and financial solutions for the reform protection of investments, but ministers were very high opinion of the contribution of the Commission and also in informing the society and disseminating myths about these negotiations and this dialogue with the society, and explanations about the significance of such an agreement are among those main aspects that we focus on during our presidency. And in this agreement, partnership with the United States will be very important, not only in the economic context, but it's clear, so facilitated trade will also contribute to our economy and job creation. It will be significant in the geopolitical context, and it will allow to achieve higher standards in global economy. We have to mention also cooperation. So that 2015 is the year of cooperation, and we focus on three large United Nations conferences. That is the Development Conference, and that's Addis Ababa in June in New York. There will be the summit about the goals for 2015, and the end of the year in Paris, there will be a summit meeting conference about climate and energy. So considerable work has been invested to find common stand, and I believe we'll manage to achieve a good result. As already said, special emphasis is on the internal security in the EU, including combating terrorism, a considerable part will be also paid to negotiations about the passengers register for the European Union, and there will also be review of the strategy for security that should be reviewed. And at the moment, there is an ongoing active preparation process, and we expect that the decision will be taken about the review of this strategy. And the European Council will be dedicated to these matters of safety and security specifically since the Lisbon strategy. And in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to say that on the one hand, we can be proud about what has been done, but I'd like to emphasize that as intensive work expects us in the coming 3 months, we have to bring to the fore the summit on the 21st and 3rd of May here in Riga. So there is intensive work going on, the consultations inside the EU and also with partners or Eastern Partnership. So in drafting the declaration, and this partnership must remain high on the agenda, also on the political agenda of the EU, a very clear vision should be outlined, and the declaration of the summit must also reflect the vision of the European Union about concerning cooperation with those partner countries that seek closer links with the European Union. And this summit would also allow, give an opportunity to assess the first association agreements and also to assess the desire expressed to for closer cooperation, and would also outline the future steps. Another significant event, which will take on 17th, 18th June, is a digital assembly, which is a very significant event in the context of the digital priority, where it will be possible, together with the sector, together with representatives of governments and experts, to discuss the proposal of the Commission about the establishment of the single digital market that is expected to be released in May. These are the most important events during the remaining 3 months of our presidency. However, I would like to emphasize that a considerable part of work until now has been done largely due to our social partners, and will be capable of undertaking and performing our tasks by seeking and finding common touch with our partners. We're very satisfied with the very close involvement of social partners in our work, and we're also very satisfied about the macroeconomic dialogue and also summit that was headed by our Prime Minister in March, together with Mr. Juncker and Mr. Tusk. And as a presiding country, we really highly appreciate the contribution of social partners and development of social dialogue, and also in document on social dialogue that was adopted yesterday, the meeting of social partners in Riga. We have also invited partner organizations, organization of social partners, to get involved in discussions with representatives of organizations from other countries, also at the conference that will take place on 23rd of April. And we expect this to be a continuation of these discussions, and we expect that we will continue cooperation with the presidencies of Luxembourg and Netherlands in continuing this work and ensuring continuity, and we'll be very happy if these presidencies will continue to work along these lines to strengthen the social dialogue. And taking account our experiences, we have gone through a very severe economic crisis. We know that one of the most important aspects of success was our ability to work closely with our social partners, to communicate with society, and thus ensuring the support of social partners and the whole of society for our very harsh measures. And it's possible to achieve anything only in close partnership the social partners, with the civil society. And this is what the Latvian presidency has focused and will focus attention on in future. So, ladies and gentlemen, I believe that we move forward in a very targeted manner, and the results I have mentioned have not been exhaustive, and the logo of our Latvian presidency is a millstone, and it has been turned in with a sure hand. We will move forward as pragmatically and with determination to work together with you, with your encouragement and with your support. Thank you very much to you. Thank you very much to Madam Parliamentary Secretary. You mentioned a whole consistent balance. I remember the will that you expressed to work together with your social partners in maintaining the social dialogue, and here, see, this is the result. Mr. Krauze, I thank you that you have found time to be with us, and you, as Vice President of the European Affairs Committee, I give the floor to you, and we will listen to you very carefully. Thank you, Mr. Dasis, honorable participants of the workers' group. I'm very honored to welcome you on behalf of our committee, but I'm very glad to be here because very recently, at the end of the previous year, I worked together with you in Brussels in the Employment and Social Committee, and we adopted very good opinions there. And this work is very valuable, and it continues. And I know that you continue working on our significant opinions and statements related to this presidency. And in this respect, I would like to express our profound gratitude to all of you, and in particular to representatives of Latvia on the Council. So, from the employers and from trade unions, Mr. Krīgers is Gavrilovs. For example, Mr. Krīgers is involved in work concerning climate change. Ms. Sabeltiņa is actually also related to the work on Central Asia, with Central Asia, and the work that you have all been doing in developing these documents is very significant for us as a presiding country. I would like to say good word, well, compliment also Ms. Kalniņa-Lukaševica for her work with non-governmental organizations and social partners. And we met also at our parliament, and I believe our work here in Latvia has achieved a very good level, and that's why I'd like to express my gratitude to her as well. It will be very difficult for me, after Ms. Kalniņa, to speak about the goals, which is competitive, Europe, digital Europe, and involvement, but I would like to focus more on the area that is related to my activities, that is the rural environment and agriculture. And as I know, those people who live in the rural areas also consider the European policy, the social policy and jobs very important. So employment and rural areas are two matters which are closely linked. At the moment, we speak about the need to create new jobs, and the new agricultural program has been focused on the creation of new jobs. And I would like to invite all of you to pay more attention to really young people, to youth employment, because we discuss these matters at such events. We say good words, but often work starts at various committees. It gets as far as different proposals, and then it encounters resistance because everything needs financial support. Also, youth employment in rural areas requires financial support, and then it doesn't look that nice anymore. Another matter which is significant is the European solidarity to overcome various difficulties, including financial difficulties. Latvia has got out of the crisis with some success. We have paid in quite considerable financial resources into European Stability Fund, where money is channeled to those countries which need it most of all. But it doesn't mean that we do not have a single problem left. I want to stress that solidarity is needed also at other levels. After the Russian crisis and after sanctions and the following embargo, some sectors have found themselves in a very difficult situation. You can imagine that not only Latvia, but other countries neighboring on, bordering on Russia, have got into more serious financial difficulties than more distant countries. Well, actually, it's only normal because we trade more with our closer neighbors. So this is a political solidary decision, and it generated difficulties. But now we have to be solidary, so the whole of Europe should help these countries, that include the Baltic states, Finland, and other countries, to overcome these difficulties. Sector.
I would like to mention the dairy sector, where Latvia is in a very special situation in comparison to the EU. When we look at the average figures, milk production is stabilized in Europe. There are positive trends, but no positive trends in the Baltic states. And also we can speak about solidarity when we compare the southern EU countries like Greece. The situation is very hard, but when we look at the overall EU data, everything is okay, but actually everything is not okay. We also have our problems. I believe that solidarity is essential. When speaking about this issue, I have to say, of course, we are very close to Russia, and of late, what has happened, the war in Ukraine, sometimes it's called a conflict, or by another word, but actually it is a war, and all the consequences influence us very much. We remember history very well. We remember the time when Latvia was occupied by the Soviet Union, and it is important think about hybrid war and Russian propaganda. It's a big problem. We feel it here in the Baltic states most of all. I was surprised when I went to a Central European country and I had a chance to talk to a lady who is from Russia, who works in the cloakroom of the Congress Center, and she expressed Putin's opinion word to word, word for word. She lives absolutely in a different information space. She doesn't listen to the local radio television, but she follows what the Kremlin is saying. And here, NGOs and social partners should work together. You, politicians, and all the organizations must work together. That's a priority that exists in this period and also in the future. It doesn't refer only to Russia, but when we look in a broader way, it refers to other regions too. I call upon you to pay attention to these issues and debate them not only in Brussels but elsewhere We live in the EU. We are very closely connected. And in order to overcome difficulties, we must follow the principle of solidarity so that external forces cannot influence, so that we have jobs, that we can develop both the towns and the countryside. Perhaps there should be more of the trade unions in the countryside too. Farmers are very individual at present, but in time, bigger enterprises might also develop in the countryside, and trade unions will have to play a bigger role in the countryside. Thank you very much.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur Krauze. Ça fait plaisir de constater que vous n'avez pas.
Thank you very much, Mr. Krauze. I remember it was. I see that you haven't forgotten your past when you worked in Brussels. We worked together with colleagues from Group 3 and Group 1. Our task is to constitute a dialogue and establish joint aims. And now I'll give the floor to my wonderful colleague, Mr. Peters Kriegers, President of the Free Trade Union Confederation of Latvia. Over to you. Good morning. Thank you very much. Thank you, colleagues, for all these good words. I am happy to hear that almost all EU member states have sent representatives of employee organization, workers' organizations. We live in one common space. We are all responsible together for people who live in this space here. We must provide that they should live in a better way. Thank you very much for colleagues from the Latvian Free Trade Union Union for your interest. And also, I hope you continue debates after the conference. And I hope also here you'll be able to put questions and perhaps express your opinion, a different opinion. We are now in the new building of the National Library, which is a new building. Latvia is also a new building in the EU. This building was recognized to be the most beautiful building in Latvia last year. So this will leave an impact on our joint debates in the hall. The workers of the National Library has its own trade union, and we have concluded a collective bargain, and we are happy that the employees of this institution has good premises to work in, and that's exactly what we discussed in the first part, that we need good working conditions and also long-term jobs. The library has provided that. We have heard many good words about cooperation in Latvia and the level of social dialogue here. Thank you to our social partners, the Confederation of Employers, social partners. We stand for this process, and we have taken care of it today we could all sit at one table together with governmental representatives and other partners, we have cooperation, we have true cooperation. There are many questions that and many issues that we have managed to solve with great difficulties and great arguments, and we do not always achieve a solution immediately. For example, Vitalis Gavrilos is sitting there and smiling, and he may say something similar to the trade union, but he has his own interests. He represents many employers in Latvia, and very often their opinion is completely different from the views of the trade unions. For example, the question about the flexibility of the labor law or the repealing of some laws in Latvia that prescribe rights. We are trying to prove that we are right, and sometimes we have to turn to the government so that they tell us who is right, or else the parliament introduces some order in our relationship. We have been actually clever all these years, and we have established a good relationship with the government and political parties, and we haven't had any crisis, and we have always found a way out of the situation. We managed to get through the financial crisis, the economic crisis, and in case we have some kind of internal conflicts if we had any conflicts, we would now live in a worse situation, and we wouldn't be able to discuss these problems in a quiet way, like, for example, migration problems, problems of young people. We know that over the last 10 years, we have lost very many young people of working age. That's a tragedy. It's not only a search for new challenges in life or studying of foreign languages, as it is very often stated. This is a protest action that our people take up because they are not satisfied with the situation. Nobody listens to us. Our opinion is not listened to, and I pack my suitcase. I go to live and work in another country. Unfortunately, one third of the active labor force has left the country, and now we have the labor resources that have been left. We try to work with them. We are trying to create a better Latvia for them locally. On the other hand, when we speak about the unemployment rate, we say that it is about very close to the average in Europe. But let's imagine a situation. If these people had not left Latvia, what would the unemployment rate be then? That'd be absolutely huge. We would have a calamity. We wouldn't be able to help them. Actually, they tried to save Latvia, and also the families who were left here in Latvia, and also the Latvia's social budget. When we speak about youth employment, Yes, we have a big unemployment among young people. So all the questions connected with education, vocational education, and qualifications have not been fully solved. There are big resources that need to be developed. Yesterday at the social forum, the chairman of the Trade Union of Health and Social Services said that the financing for health and medical services is very far from what we need. Medical nurses receive less than the average. They are not well paid. If we see that in the EU has about 7% of the budget goes for health services. In Latvia, it's only 3%. So this is not taking care of healthy people in your country. Then the question is, what about the other investments that we have, Juncker's investment and so on? How will it be geared for people with a low level of education and poor health, or it is oriented towards people that they are professionally trained, healthy, strong, so that they can create added value?
So a certain contradiction emerges that we have not been able to solve over these years, and that is why perhaps there's this talk that various campaigns of protest should be organized. And as far as I understand, the trade unions of medical workers and education workers plan to organize it on 20th of April, when the ministers for health come together for an informal meeting here in Riga. They also want to attract attention to these problems of the sector. They are not only positive talks about our conversation and how well everything has been organized and how well we have addressed all the matters and have managed to get out of the crisis. There is also a shadowy side to it, and we have not spoken too much about it, and very often people put questions to us. Why more is said about the situation of crisis in other countries, but what the crisis was in Latvia and how we are crawling out of the pit of the crisis, because the crisis is not yet over? Why is nothing said about that? At the moment, minimum wages is 360 euros. So a lot of people, one-third of all the working population, earn this minimum salary and live on that. We have such a salary in education, in healthcare, and in culture, in libraries, in museums. This minimum salary is much lower than the average wage in other countries. So, for example, country where my dear good friend George comes from, their minimum wage is much higher, and our average wage, which is somewhat above 700 euros, this is not sort of the dream threshold that we could think of and speak of also in the context of the crisis. Our people put such questions. If we speak about solidarity in the single territory of the European Union, why those issues that arise for people outside politics, outside trade unions, for those people who get this information from the mass media, why there is no equal treatment, there is no solidarity in respect of these matters? And most probably that's another matter that we, sitting at this table, have failed to do. If we speak about Juncker's investment plan, quite a lot of people in Latvia, in particular the small and medium businessmen, also put the question, who will get the money, what projects will be able to apply for these loans, what terms and conditions there would be, or will really the money get as far as those places where the enterprises might be sustainable, but they are small, but they have development potential. All this money will go to the large transnational companies with several thousands of employees who have large production volumes, who will cream it off and will be able to develop, and the richer will become more richer, while the poor will stay where they are at the moment. And when we see that there is no actual answer, and if it's said that politicians will have no impact on the processes and it will be decided by exits, our people who see that quite a lot of issues are regulated and resolved by politicians still believe that political parties will play a very significant role in determining ways of having access to these funds. And at the moment, we plan large investment. We have plans for large investment projects and hopes for large amounts of money. A new railroad, Rail Baltic, planned from the north to the south. And again, people put the question, is that a primary investment project? Well, we are told that it'll be a fast-track railroad, but what about the value added that it will have? The population asks, perhaps, that there should be some link created to link the gas pipeline and the electricity grid, and it should be perhaps more important than to have a railroad and a train running from Riga to other places. It means that people will have an opportunity to get away in comfort getting to Europe. As you see, there are quite a lot of matters for discussion. And internally, we also very often mention these matters, but as a presiding country, we will also have to give answers, and we will have to seek solutions for a diversity of issues. As concerns our problems, most probably we could speak as long as you could speak about your problems, because no country in the EU is an ideal, and the situation is not ideal in any of the EU member states. But in this situation, what is positive is that through the presidency activities, we have mobilized ourselves internally, and we have managed to overcome some daily routine arguments and disagreements concerning certain matters, trying to achieve a higher value added, with the full understanding that presidency in the EU is not only work for Mrs. Straujuma, our Prime Minister, or Ms. Lukaševica, but it is work for all of us, and we share the responsibility for these processes. And this is where I would like to finish. Thank you. Thank you very much to Peter. And now I give the floor to our colleague, Mr. Vitalis Gavrilos, and we will listen very attentively to him, because we will remember your speech and we will use it in our further activities in Brussels. Dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, on behalf of Latvian Confederation of Employers, I'd like to welcome you here in Riga, in Latvia, at our National Library. We understand that 2015 is very important for all of us. First and foremost, we have new leaders in Europe, we have new leaders in Latvia, and this year, So the ECOSOC will have new leaders, and I think that's, there's some significance why Mr. Dasis has come to Riga. It's like a pre-election campaign, and well, probably he will continue his career in this committee. We may expect to see him quite often in Latvia, and perhaps we could dedicate one of the plenary sessions here, not only have these plenary sessions in Brussels. That would be quite interesting. But I, a representative of employers and social partners, and as a full-fledged participant of this meeting today, I'm absolutely convinced that the new direction taken by the European Commission to put the social dialogue to better use and to use the influence of social partners to influence the society to ensure also growth is a very correct direction to take to ensure the sustainability of growth in Europe. Business Europe growth barometer shows that those countries where reforms that are being undertaken are supported by the employers' organizations actually get back to the path of growth. And our tripartite council and cooperation with government, where Madam Minister President is also a co-chairperson, is an example of a success story in this country, how to sustain social peace and to develop social dialogue, as my colleague Peter just said. After the recovery and after successful fiscal policy within the framework of tripartite dialogue, Latvia recovered the development rate, and we have achieved the pre-crisis rate. We hope that we'll manage it, and we're happy about, and we also intend to achieve the goals of the Strategy 2020, and we believe that there is a good beginning for cooperation with social dialogue, and I'm certain that social dialogue is the main means to implement the initiatives put forward by the European Commission to promote the economic development of the EU and the development of a single market, including that for plan for attracting investments, energy union, and the establishment of a capital union, and to ensure the successful development of business activities, the most important prerequisite is an environment favorable for investments in each country and the EU in totality. And the business must be certain that the EU is a simple, predictable, and transparent, has transparent regulation that eliminates red tape. The EU has competitive costs, including the energy prices, labor costs, labor taxes, to ensure the industrial potential of the EU and to provide jobs in the EU, and also to reduce imbalances in the EU and at the global level. So we have been speaking from the very morning, mentioning the comparisons between the United States and the European Union. As you see, so there's been a decrease of oil prices in the United States while the prices have grown in Europe. So then the tax burden in the United States is much lower than here. So, but the question is about also cross-border competition. We might have competitive products, but inappropriate price. I believe for the coming 5 years, the imbalance will be one of the main obstacles. We must reduce it as far as possible at all levels, including training of labor force, where training provided to labor is better in the United States. In the EU, including all the regions, including the Baltic, our safe environment for investments, because the EU policy and the NATO policy ensure geopolitical stability, to also convince us about the stability of investment, security of investments. When we speak about geopolitics, now we understand very well, we listen to the presentation, why the geopolitical tensity in the U.S. We have still, they have high GDP, but with us the stagnations that goes on. So we have to look at the experience of other countries. Another matter related to geopolitics is, so whether you look at the situation by region or at the EU, we need a global strategy for the EU from the point of business. It's far more important. So we say that our priority is Eastern partnership, Central Asian partnership. What about global strategy? If we don't have global strategy and we cannot choose the right priorities, we start hesitating. And what's the outcome? So employment, welfare, what do we get? What do we get in Europe? We've got war in Europe. So a politician like a diplomat must be very pragmatic. And I fully support what Mr. Juncker said. The social partners must be involved in discussing geopolitical issues, because those who manufacture and provide services, those who really take care of the economic growth, we must be involved to try time and again to look at those ambitious political aims, and sometimes they are only populistic, and we cannot support such goals. And that's why our common task and responsibility is to ensure provide support to local and to foreign investors. And we have to convince them that growth in Europe will continue, and the results of growth can be experienced and felt by every inhabitant. And we must say that this is the place for safe investment. You will definitely have return on your investment. And if we can't manage to do this, Juncker's plan has no hope. And why, for example, public-private partnership, why doesn't it work in the area of investment? Why don't we trust each other? We do not trust local politicians and local governments. Local governments don't trust. Investments go down. In the United States, investments have gone up.
I'm sure that everybody realizes that the only way to overcome the crisis is business activities that at the national level and the EU security and future depends on the success of the investments, whether we can or cannot provide new jobs in Europe. We turn to you to think about it and influence this process the way you okay. That's why Latvian Presidency and the Latvian Employer Confederation participated in the social forum yesterday, and we hosted our social partners and colleagues from 28 EU countries, and we were also happy to host Mr. Dombrovskis, who worked here in Latvia before that, and we analyzed the examples of good practice here in Latvia and examples of co-participation to create jobs at all levels. While the European Commission only is thinking about these questions, Latvia can be proud of the tripartite agreement and cooperation with the crisis before the crisis, tripartite cooperation with the government before the crisis and after it, and bilateral relations with these organizations is very important. We have good practice that can be taken an example for by other EU countries. This cooperation should be at the level of enterprises and sectors, all the social partners, the president, the commission should join forces on at the meeting on the 22nd of April here in Riga. And all the 28 member states will participate, and all the pragmatic questions will be addressed, including recommendations for the member states. For example, we need coordinators who will coordinate this work among the 28 member states and see how the national programs are developing. I call upon you to get acquainted with this material, and perhaps also you are welcome to give your recommendations. Latvian President has come forward with its proposals in good time, and we have worked together in real terms, and that's why we have an outcome from all these conferences. Latvian Employers Confederation has made a big contribution to this work, to work for a competitive Europe, for a digital Europe, Europe should have a global dimension. The Minister of Foreign Affairs of Latvia has already evaluated the impact in medium terms. We have only two ways ahead of us. To gain success together, or else to face a failure each separately. We need a true union of all the bodies and banks and approximation in political terms. The USA is strong because they are united. Europe and also Latvia very often are too pragmatic. We need to be integrated. Today we see integration and we think about our future, how our children and grandchildren will live and work. We stand for a healthy Europe. We want to be one healthy family. May we enjoy success. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Gavrilov. Now we shall give the floor to Mr. Govinč. I know that I support freedom of speech, but I do not know whether everybody will have time to get the floor. Mr. Govinč, perhaps try to speak in a shorter way, be brief. Thank you very much for this possibility to address you here in Riga. And thanks for the organization of this very important event. We do not have to reinvent the wheel. Yes, what we hear from the leaders of the EU trade union leaders and all the conversation that we hear during the coffee breaks are really very rich, and I see that Latvian trade unions make use of it for networking purposes and taking over good practice. We have here invited all the leaders. If I may, I would like to expand my gratitude, and I would like to say thank you to Peters and Ariane for what you have done in the Social Committee. This conference stands for solidarity. Yes, we have got used to it over this year. We speak a lot about solidarity. And when I speak to Peters and employers, when we were preparing for the EU budget period, actually, we worked at this question 4 years ago together with Peters and Ariana. To achieve just area payments in agriculture, and then cohesion funds that are also very important in terms of solidarity, where the initial position of the EU was to let's diminish this, the cohesion fund, let the rich become richer and the poor will remain the way they are. We manage to include in the official documents these issues of solidarity in very clear terms, so nobody could reproach us that the Social Committee had not worked at these questions for years. In the morning, we heard what money flows go for energy, Juncker's plan for banks and everywhere. Very much of this money is geared for intergovernmental talks and negotiations and agreements. This is a critical point. I would have liked a bigger total budget of the EU, a more clear cohesion policy, more investment in innovation and energy too, so that we could speak about solidarity at the scale, on the scale of the EU, not in just a few countries. I would like to say thank you to trade unions and the Latvian trade unions, which is the flagship that breaks the ice for Latvia, so that NGOs could participate, that they could be heard and participate in decision making. I would agree with Mr. Gavrilos that Latvia's great opportunities. The social dialogue is at a very good level, and civil participation is at a very good level. We have excellent NGOs have a possibility to participate in the meetings of the Cabinet of Ministers, give their opinion, participate in the Commission meetings without any complicated procedures. That's everyday work, and that's also the merit of the Prime Minister. And also, we have these high representatives here. We have this everyday cooperation with NGOs and participation of the civil society will help us to inspire the European Union and also help us to prevent and do away with the drawbacks that we have still got in Latvia. A few words on the Latvian trade union organization. I believe it is very important, and thank you for that, that your organization works in a European style. They understand the significance of the EU. It's not like an umbrella organization, but they have a very modern viewpoint. and that influences our life in Latvia, and these decisions are taken at the level of the EU, and the work is very active. Now, evaluation, to evaluate Latvian presidenture, what happened in the Committee of Social Affairs, that's really great. Ariane organizes work very well. Latvia is really seen in Europe, a photo exhibition, for example, and also the aims have been presented well together with Peter Zanda and Mr. Gavrilovs, and this work is well done. And also to with the Mrs. Weyre, Vike Freiberger, and also Zanda Kalniņa have shown us the way.
On the work of the presidency in Latvia. Most things have been said by Zanda, Kalniņa-Lukaševica, so I won't go into those details and traditional things. It would be a very subjective evaluation from my side, which I would like to offer, and those would be only 3 points, so I'll try to keep it short. First, I think this presidency is very special that we don't only talk about things, but we live them. We implement those things which we do. As I mentioned, the participation is one of the priorities, is one of the aspects which we see as well in this event, that the Prime Minister attends, and that we have meetings which are open to audience, civil society players. The same is in relation with the Eastern Partnership priority. We see that in the big meetings, is it on education, is it Parliament-organized presidency events, there is always neighbor country representatives at the same table, participating in the debates and sharing already a wider European perspective on the things which are discussed. So we live the things, we don't talk only about them. Second, we're not extremely ambitious in Latvia, but we do the things, again, we do the things which we have stated. And again, I think this is a very good example that we don't promise too much. We don't promise the things which we can't implement. And the recipe for success is, I think, a close link between all players on EU level. We have the Economic and Social Committee, of course, only as one of the players. I think the dynamism which we see, the dynamics and synergies between the Council and the new Commission, with a special role as well of Vice President Mr. Dombrovskis in bringing forward social dialogue, civil society participation, and a lot of other issues as the semester. I think that is one of the keys for success, and it is the first presidency with a full parliament and commission, a full new parliament and commission, which allows perhaps as well really to create new ideas and bring them forward, and I'm very happy to see these. The last point which I would like to mention is, of course, a presidency is prepared, but not everything goes in accordance with what is prepared, because a lot of things happen in outside world which force us to change and to be adapting to these realities. And I think one of the big issues where as well the Economic and Social Committee plays an important role is the big wave of propaganda and manipulation, radicalism, terrorism, growing and coming up in different EU member states and in different ways. We have on the one side we have the radical Islamists, on the other side we have as well in Latvia as well as in other countries radical Russian fighters going to Ukraine. So it's not only people going to Syria fighting there and coming back as well with a great terroristic potential. It is the same propaganda influence which we see from the East as well coming, influencing a lot of citizens of Latvia as well going to Ukraine, fighting there, and where we face the same common European problems with this terrorism and radicalism. I think there is a lot of things which we can do. We have started really well, that actually 2 years before this presidency there were first close cooperation possibilities with the government, with social partners, with NGOs and other players. The program was designed commonly, jointly, and I'm very happy that we are also working on its implementation jointly. Thank you, Mr. President, for this great conference and for being here in Latvia.
Merci beaucoup, Andris.
I thank you very much, and I hope that you, as well as Mr. Gavrilos, will be with us during the afternoon session, because the debate will continue. But I have a request. If you could devote some time to us, we would give them back to you during the break. If you could devote some time to us, if you could give us a quarter of an hour, at least we will allow you 25 minutes later. I would like to ask you, Ali, so to enable people to put questions. Now we want to put questions to the parliamentary secretary and other parliamentaries, because Mrs. Krauze cannot be here. There's somebody who already wants to take the floor. So, Verhoeven, Mr. Verhoeven, Pierre-Jean Colomb. So, without any introductions, without philosophical aspects, direct questions, please, for the President. Denis. I had forgotten Denis during the previous round of questions. We will start with these questions now. Now it's Bernard first. Thank you, Mr. President. I wanted to express some considerations, but now I will refrain from that and go to my question direct. Mr. Parliamentary Secretary, Madam Parliamentary Secretary, you mentioned in your comment what has been already done. You also mentioned the development of the problem of developing quality jobs, which is the focus of attention and concern for all trade unions everywhere. But most probably this question is more directed to social partners. Whether these quality jobs and their development is a global concept, or the social partners have looked for criteria, for objectives, for targets. How could they reach an agreement on what quality jobs are? Have we really found and have we really sought certain targets here? Thank you for this brief question. So Pierre-Jean Colomb, the next question, please. So, another question that is addressed to these speakers. You spoke about possibility of developing common platform during the meeting in Paris. Could you mention more about it? Because as you know, conclusions and views in various involved parties will be given by June. Do you really think that some common standpoint might have emerged by this conference in November? And whether this common viewpoint will be presented, is there any speaker who will do it? And now let's give the floor to Representative Chechen. I'll be also very brief. The question concerns the review of the regulation about maternity leave, because I believe during Latvian presidency this issue should have been reviewed, but it was removed from the agenda, and it causes concern among us. at least we want to have a declaration passed. We passed a declaration on the 18th of March. It is at your disposal. And could we do anything to not to have this review removed from the agenda? A representative of Belgian Trade Union. Thank you. I also would like to put a question to Madame Parliament Secretary. You spoke about preparation for the Paris Conference about climate change, but I'd like to know to what extent the Latvian Presidency at the moment is getting ready for the New York Conference in September about sustainable development after 2015. And what about this preparation process? What stage is it in? And the same question is also concerns the possibility of Europe speaking in this in a united voice. So thank you. And last question, if I haven't overlooked anyone, but first and foremost, I believe first the question will be put by. Thank you. I'd like to thank those speakers who showed us what was going on in Latvia. I had several questions which would go to the Parliamentary Secretary and concerning demographics in Latvia, for example, and about this immigration, which might be viewed as dramatic, judging by the statistics provided by the government. Does the government have any policy in stimulating birth rate so that this fall in the birth rate can be overcome? Are there any priorities in the direction of digital Europe? Because I think about the aging of the population. Has this aspect been assessed? And as concerns digitalization, one more aspect. Do you think that directive that is in the process of being prepared about protection of personal data is sufficient? Shouldn't more be done? Thank you to Laura. And then the last question is from Lithuania, from Lithuanian Trade Union.
Plenarist and all social partners for this very good event and a very interesting debate. I would like just a few comments and maybe questions. Concerning Eastern Partnership, you mentioned that it's one of the priorities of Latvian Presidency neighborhood policy. So there will be Eastern Partnership Civil Society Conference on 21st of May. And I saw the draft of the program, and unfortunately there are no social partners involved in the program. Even there be a debate on economic transference, about social inclusion, social process, social policy. So I would really to ask, it's only politicians, some maybe scientific, and people coming from Eastern Partnership and from EU, but no social partners. So please, I think that we need to involve social partners, employers, trade unions in Eastern Partnership more. So it's one of my point, and the second is about, it's for social partners. We talked about investments, and we talk about solidarity. When Lithuania was at the presidency of EU, we had this European guarantee initiative. So are you involved still in how it's about youth guarantee initiative? Are you involved in this, or you just forgot it? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Daiva. Madame la Ministre, à vous la parole.
So, as the questions were posed in French, and my French is not so good to answer, then maybe I will stick to my Latvian, not to make damage. for this.
Thank you for the many questions. We had 6 questions, and a whole range of questions was put during the presentations of my colleagues, but I'll take it according to the sequence. First, about the jobs and quality jobs, and if I understood the question correctly, whether we have one single concept, how we can measure what is quality job, what's not, and how to develop them. Firstly, I must say that it's clear that economic growth and job creation are among the main priorities in the EU. When we look at the main key issues that we address, they all contribute to the development of job creations. Juncker's investment plan and the partnership and the digital market and the single market and the agreement with the United States. It's clear that large investments generate an effect. That they are followed by smaller investments, and that jobs are created also in the small and medium enterprises. We have seen it in Latvia, where Valmiera is one of the more developed cities, and there's a fiber plant, and it's been developing and providing services very actively, and it's classical. It's a classical way how it operates everywhere, and that's why Juncker's investment plan, through large important strategic investments, will give the added impetus to this development. As concerns the question what a quality job is, it depends on the interests of each individual, the abilities and the challenges. We can say that a quality job is a position or an office in the cabinet of ministers, but there be thousands of people who would not be ready for that. And for them, a quality job is to be able to open their bakery or florist shop in their own native village. That's why we have to develop an environment where every person may develop his talents and may achieve his heart's desire in line with his possibilities, with his education and skills, may find and work a job that he likes, be it president of the state or the local baker in a small village. So we have to develop a favorable environment, overall environment. Well, I tried to be brief, so my questions. So on second question concerning the climate and the overall EU attitude, and the fourth speaker also asked about preparation for the New York summit in September. And both of you asked about the development of our overall EU attitude. 2 weeks ago, there was an informal meeting for the ministers for development, where discussed ways how to come to a united opinion about development goals. Definitely, it's also related to development goals for 2015. And all the time we hear in these discussions, so reference to the climate conference in Paris taking place at the end of the year. And there's a commitment among ministers for development and also in the council to have one single EU position. So there is one voice in the EU, is our strategic aim. And that's why we move towards this common standpoint step by step to achieve it. And I'm optimistic about it.
We also see from the conversation rounds in New York while preparing for the September New York conference that already it is possible to come to an agreement among the member states, and this way these member states support the joint position. That's of course a challenge, but I hope that the EU will cope with it. And at the very last development meeting that I participated in, give me every hope that this is possible. When we come down to the question about maternity leave, yes, it is a very difficult question. I know it is not easy to find a solution. I know for how many years the EU member states have had debates on this question. The Council has no uniform opinion, and the Commission has its own opinion, and the EP also insists that we must make our way forward. The pragmatic approach of the Latvian Presidency, our aim is to achieve an agreement. And this aim is not just one document or one file. We recognize that it's not possible to come to an agreement with the present wording, and the EU Commission wants to look at it again to make this question move forward. It'll be easier to start with working with a new document than to keep to the old document without any result. The question about immigration and support incentive for a rise in birth rates, about digital economy from Latvia to the EU. In Latvia, immigration has been a very severe problem during the crisis, and the government has recognized it and has worked out a plan of re-emigration. We are moving forward step by step, although it's moving very slowly. Unfortunately, we haven't got a magic way how to solve it and how to provide many well-paid jobs in Latvia. We know our experience has it that very rapid growth is not possible here. The aim is to keep up links with our compatriots abroad and provide possibilities for them to return. And also, we have special education programs so that the children who do return can have education here. I believe that this is a question that is being discussed in the EU context, because free movement of people and workforce is one of our principles. Of course, we need to keep up our links with our native country and keep the possibility to be able to return. A digital united market has a potential. There are thousands of well-paid jobs in digital economy that can give us one of the answers. We can develop a dynamic, a new potential branch of economy that will allow us to work in one place and offer our services in another place. And here, one of the files that the package of data protection that's very important also in our negotiations with the EP. I like the way you put all these issues together. This question actually calls for many answers. Eastern Partnership and Civic Forum and the involvement of social partners are important. Cooperation is important, and we have the summit, we have the civil forum. As Mr. Gavrilos mentioned, Eastern Partnership is one of the events, and it'll go together with a business forum, the biggest business forum during our presidency, and here employers play a great role, and social partners will be involved, and they'll be present. And of course, all these agendas are still being worked at, and I hope we shall have a good balance in all the events, how to attract more of the partners. In March, we had a forum for young people in Eastern Partnership. So there were representatives from NGOs of young people from Eastern countries. And finally, youth guarantees. The question is important. Latvia is one of the first countries that started the implementation of the issue of youth guarantees already on the 2nd of January, while other countries were having still discussions. The youth initiative started on the 2nd of January in 2014. Involvement in qualification courses, training, also support for youth business initiatives, and discussions are continuing at the EU level. This question is also discussed at the Council of Ministers dealing with youth employment. We must re-evaluate what we have achieved. We have some countries where there's good experience, and we have to exchange experience, and many things can be still done much better. Youth employment is part of economic sustainability. It has a very big also role in our struggle against radicalism, because these forces try to get many young people on their side. To provide good jobs is one of the safe replies to all these challenges. To sum it up, thank you very much for the questions. Thank you for the addresses and the words of praise expressed by Mr. Krieger, Mr. Gavrilov, and Mr. Gorbinj. Make our way forward. I am certain that the questions connected with the Juncker's investment plan, digital industries, the single market, and links with the US are very important, decisive elements to enhance the economy, to achieve a more dynamic economy in the EU, much more rapid, and we shall be able to establish qualitative long-term jobs. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Minister. I cannot make use of the interpreters much longer. I know that you'll be able to participate in our discussions in the afternoon too. I have another proposal. Our Latvian colleagues have requests. Could we have a family photo here in front of the hall? Afterwards, we shall have lunch and also interpreters are invited to participate in the family photo, and then we shall continue our work afterwards at 14:45, at 3:15 p.m. We shall continue at 14:45, and perhaps we shall be able to finish our work earlier, so your interpreting time will be compensated. Thank you very much.